اللهم اهدنا فيمن هديت، وعافنا فيمن عافيت، وتولنا فيما توليت، وبارك لنا. وقنا واصرف عنا شر ما قضيت. اللهم قنا واصرف عنا شر ما قضيت.
أعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا، من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له، وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله. رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي امري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقه قولي. In the name of Allah, the most compassionate, the most merciful. All praises, worship, total submission and obedience belongs to Allah, the Lord, the Creator, the Originator, the Sustainer, and the Controller of the Universe. May His peace and blessings be upon our noble Prophet, the Universal Prophet and Messenger, the Spirit of Truth, the helper, the counselor, in the person of the Holy Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. I am very much happy to have been given this opportunity to speak on one of the most important topics in both the religion of Islam and Christianity, called Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam in the light of the Judeo-Christian scripture. That means Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam in the light of the Christian Bible, not in the light of the Quran, because we have already believed in Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam within the context of the Quran. He was the one who was given the revelation of the glorious Quran, but the one of contention here is our Christian brethren, irrespective of the church they belong to, whether the Jehovah Witnesses, the Catholic Church, the Hebrew Bible Church, the Assemblies of God Church, the Celestial Church, Cherubim and Seraphim, the Baptist Church, the Anglican Church, the Presbyterian Church, and other Muslim and Kangaroo churches, do not recognize Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam as a prophet of God. They rejected the message of the Holy Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. They condemned the prophethood of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And that is the reason why we want to show them the profile of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam in their own Bible, irrespective of the Bible they have, whether the Christian version, the Protestant version, the International Bible, the New American Bible, the Jehovah's Witness Bible, the Amplified Bible, the New English Bible, the Catholic Grace version of the Bible, the Everyday Bible, any of the version of the Bible that we can have. They are requested to come along with that particular Bible, because the Bible says in the book of John, chapter 8, verse 32, that seek ye the truth, and the truth shall set you free. So the Bible commanded the Christian to seek for the truth, to ask for the truth, you know, and that the truth will set them free. That is exactly what Jesus said in the book of John, chapter 8, verse 32. And also the Bible says in the book of Isaiah, chapter 1, verse 18, that, oh come, let us reason together. Let us reason together. The Quran also says, Orhatu Burhanakum. Say, come in the life of the Christian Bible, and you will see the picture of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam in the Bible. You will see the profile of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam in the Bible. You will see the characteristic of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam in the Bible, and you will know that Jesus alaihi salam, before he left the world, he prophesied about the coming of a powerful prophet, about the coming of a universal prophet, about the coming of the leader of all the prophets in the person of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. But before I continue, let me give you this good news, lest I forget. Yesterday, there was a debate organized by the Association of Muslim Professionals in Edo between the Christian and the Muslims. And the Almighty Allah blessed that debate with the Christian convert to Islam.
Amen.
Unfortunately for Abraham, he had no son. Abraham was yearning for a son, yet he had no son. Abraham had a wife. The name of this wife of Abraham was Sarah. Sarah was the first wife of Abraham. Sarah, in her old age, about 19 years, she could not deliver any son to Abraham. Later, when Abraham, was with Sarah in their matrimonial home, they had a male that was given to Abraham from Egypt. And the name of that male was Hagar. She was the daughter of a king called King Abimelech of Egypt. This King Abimelech wanted to raise the wife of Abraham, alayhi salam. But he could not succeed because of some miraculous power that descended on her whenever he touched her, he gets shot. And he later recognized her to be the wife of a man of God, a prophet of God. Then King Abimelech said unto Abraham, why don't you tell me that you are a man of God, a prophet of God? And he asked Sarah, why don't you tell me that you are the wife of a man of God, a prophet of God? So that king decided, after recognizing Abraham to be a prophet of God, he took his daughter, his biological daughter, and he said unto Abraham that this is a gift for me to you. For it is better for my daughter to be a slave in the house of a prophet of God, a man of God, than for her to be a housewife in the house of somebody that is not a prophet of God. That was his calculation. He preferred his daughter to be a slave in the house of a prophet of God. So, after giving his daughter to Abraham, as God planned it, they could not have an issue. Then Sarah called her husband Abraham, and he said unto Abraham, Abraham, my husband, take this woman, Hagar, take this woman, Hagar, slave woman, and let her be your wife, because I have been with you for quite a long time without having an issue. Therefore, marry Hagar as your second wife, so that we will have an issue through her. And the Bible says in Genesis chapter 16, verses 2 to 3, that Abraham, listening to the voice of Sarah, his first wife, and he took Hagar to be his second wife. The Bible there addressed Hagar as the wife of Abraham, meaning the second wife of Abraham. So, according to that portion of the Bible, Abraham had two wives. The first wife of Abraham was Sarah, and the second wife of Abraham was Hagar. She was no longer a slave woman, even though she was a princess, the daughter of the king of Egypt. She became the wife of a prophet of the Almighty Allah in the person of Abraham. Now when Abraham and Hagar, meaning Hagar, were together as husband and wife, the Bible says she conceived, meaning she became pregnant. And when she was pregnant, Sarah, the first wife of Abraham, became jealous of her. According to that portion of the Bible. And she started talking to her ruthlessly, according to that portion of the Bible, to the extent that left the house of Abraham with her pregnancy. Then according to the book of Genesis chapter 16, verses 7 to 11, Genesis chapter 16, verses 7 to 11, the angel of God found
They came together and they buried their own father.
each man came from the land of Saudi Arabia, and they combined together and they buried Abraham their father, you know, at Babylon. Then what happened? The Jews descended from Abraham through Isaac. The Arab descended from Abraham through who? Through Ishmael. Then what happened later?
God Almighty
established a covenant with the second son of Abraham called Isaac. That was the first covenant. By raising many prophets from the lineage of Abraham through Isaac. You know, prophets like David, prophets like Solomon, prophets like Moses, prophets like Aaron, prophets like Zechariah, prophets like John the Baptist, prophets like Jeremiah, prophets like Ezekiel, prophets like Job, and so many other prophets. And Jesus was the last prophet that was raised from among the Jews through the lineage of Isaac. After Jesus, God had never raised any prophet from among the Jews. And Jesus told the Jews in the book of Matthew chapter 21, verses 42 to 43, Jesus said to the Jews, did you never read in the scriptures, the stone that was rejected by the builders has become the chief cornerstone? This is the Lord doing, and it is marvelous in our eyes. Verily, verily, I say unto you, the kingdom of God shall be taken away from you, the Jews, and it will be given to the other nation that bear the proper fruit. Jesus said, did you ever read in the scriptures, the stone which was rejected by the builders has become the chief cornerstone? This is the Lord doing, and it is marvelous in our eyes. Verily, verily, I say unto you, the kingdom of God shall be taken away from you, and it will be given to the other nation, not nations. He said, the kingdom of God will, the headquarter of Islam. Prophet who shall be taken away from you, the Jew, and it will be given to the other nation that bear the proper fruit. Matthew chapter 21, verses 42 to 43. Now let us analyze this statement of Jesus. First, Jesus said, the stone rejected by the builders. Who was the stone rejected by the builders? If you want to know the stone rejected by the builders, you have to go back to the Bible. In the book of Genesis, chapter 21, verses 8 to 10. When Hagar gave back to Ishmael, and Sarah gave back to Isaac, and Isaac was too away from the house because of her son Isaac, because she wanted her son to inherit the whole property of Abraham. Abraham was not happy because of the statement of Sarah, and Sarah made this statement out of jealousy, because according to the Jewish law, if a man has two sons from different wives, you know, the elder son will have double of the property of the father after his death as an inheritance. This is mentioned in the book of Deuteronomy chapter 21, verses 15 to 17. And Sarah was aware of this Deuteronomic law. Therefore, she wanted her son Isaac to inherit the property of Abraham without Ishmael. So she advised that Abraham should send away Hagar and Ishmael away from the house. In the book of Genesis chapter 21, verse 13, and God said to Abraham, Abraham, listen to what Sarah has said unto you, because I will make a great and separate nation from the son of Hagar. Therefore, listen to what Sarah has said unto you. Why did God Almighty commanded Abraham to listen to what Sarah has said, in spite of the fact that Sarah made her statement out of jealousy? The reason was that the statement of Sarah, the first wife of Abraham, for Abraham to send away Ishmael and his mother away from the house, coincided with the plan of God to make a separate nation for Ishmael and a separate nation for Isaac. Therefore, even if Sarah did not utter that word, Ishmael and Hagar have to in both the Egyptian and the Arabic language, Hadra means storm, like Hadra al-Aswad in Saudi Arabia, the black one. So Hadra and Ishmael were the storm rejected by the builders, which has become the chief cornerstone. And Jesus said, this is the Lord's doing, and it is fabulous in our eyes. Why did Jesus say that it is fabulous in our eyes? Because a powerful prophet, a mighty prophet, the leader of all the prophets, a universal prophet, will emerge from that particular family, from that particular descendant of Abraham, through the second wife of Abraham called Hagar. And that is the reason why Jesus said, verily, verily, I say unto you, the kingdom of God shall be taken away from you, the Jews, and it will be given to the other nation. What other nation? The Arab. The Arab nation. Because the Jews nation and the Arab nation descended from Abraham, and it is Arab. Israel represented the Arabs. Isaac represented the Jews. So God
had established his
covenant with the Jews people, and Jesus was the last fulfillment of that covenant from the Jews' line. Now, remember the other
line, meaning the other family tree of
Abraham. And Jesus says, God will take away his kingdom from you and he will give it to the other nation, bearing the proper fruit. The Bible further explains this to promised nation in the book of Deuteronomy chapter 18, verse 18. And I quote, God Almighty said unto Moses, meaning he was speaking to the Jewish people through the mouth of Moses, I will raise them up a prophet from among their brethren, like unto you, Moses, and I will put my words in his mouth, and he shall speak unto them all that I shall command him. And it shall come to pass that whosoever does not hearken unto my words, which that prophet will speak in my name, I will punish that particular person. Now, God says to the children of Israel through the mouth of Moses, is revealed unto him who cannot read, saying, Israel, read. And he said, I am not learned. Meaning, the book, that is the Quran, is revealed unto him, meaning unto the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, who cannot read, saying, Israel, read. And he said, I am not learned. This is what the Bible says. This prophecy was made about 1,300 years before the advent of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And Allah says in the Quran, chapter 26, verse 192-193, وَإِنَّهُ لَتَنْزِيلُ رَبِّ الْعَالَمِينَ, that this Quran is a revelation from the Lord of the world. نَزَلَ بِهِ الرُّوحُ الْأَمِينُ, the trustworthy spirit has put it, descended with it. You know, نَزَلَ بِهِ الرُّوحُ الْأَمِينُ, was computerized in the heart of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. It was implanted in the heart of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Bilisan al-Arabiyyin Mubin, in an eloquent Arabic language, that is the one. and to punish that particular person. In whose name was Muhammad speaking? Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. In the name of Allah, they were beneficent, they were merciful. That is how each of the chapters of the Quran begins, with the exception of chapter 9. And that Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim was put to Tawbah, is found in chapter 27 of the Quran, in the Holy Spirit Allah, where in the Holy Spirit Allah. Now the question is, when was this prophecy mentioned in Deuteronomy 18:18 fulfilled? This prophecy was not fulfilled in the lifetime of John the Baptist. It was not fulfilled in the lifetime of Jesus, according to what the Bible says, until after Jesus left the world, according to what the Bible says. In the book of John, chapter 1, verses 19-21, the Bible
that when he said that he saw the Lord, remember, O Muhammad, one cry
question is, are the Christians ready to believe the word the Quran says that Jesus was only sent to the Jews? No, they are not ready. What if they see the statement of Jesus? What if they hear the statement of Jesus? Jesus made it categorically clear in simple language that does not need the assistance of the Holy Spirit to understand that statement. In Matthew chapter 15, verse 24. Matthew chapter 15, verse 24. Jesus said, I was sent only to the lost sheep of the house of Israel. I was sent only to the lost sheep of the house of Israel. Do you need the assistance of any teacher to understand the simple language? I was sent only to the lost sheep of the house of Israel. I was sent only, mark that word, only. I was sent only to the lost sheep of the house of Israel. Meaning, this means that Jesus was not sent to any other nation other than the lost sheep of the house of Israel. And who are the lost sheep of the house of Israel? The chosen. So Jesus told them that, I was sent only to you, was fallen in Adam in Israel. Also, Quran chapter 3, verse 29. He was meant to be a messenger only to the children of Israel. Was that Allah for Muslim and never in Israel? Quran chapter 43, verse 51. Allah says, and I met Jesus as a messenger only to the children of Israel. And fortunately also, we found it written from the Bible, from the lips of Jesus, that I was sent only to the lost sheep of the house of Israel. This indicates that Jesus was not sent to America, he was not sent to China, he was not sent to Australia, he was not sent to Ghana, he was not sent to Saudi Arabia, he was not sent to Canada, he was not sent to Germany, he was not sent to India, he was not sent to Togo, he was not sent to Nigeria, he was not sent to Sudan, he was not sent to Syria, he was not sent to Iraq, he was not sent to Iran, he was not sent to any of the world other than the lordship of the house of Israel. In the book of Matthew, chapter 10, verse 6, when Jesus was telling his 12 disciples to go and preach, he said, as you are going, don't go to any person that is not a Jew. Go not unto the way of the Gentiles, nor unto any house of the Samaritan, but go only to the lordship of the house of Israel. But was shown, then truly, yet remember this to go ahead. And I am giving you the good news, the glad tidings of a mighty messenger that will come after you. And his name is Ahmad, the great one, the comforter, the spirit of truth, the counselor, the advocate. I am giving you the good news of a messenger, a mighty prophet that will come after me. And his name is Ahmad. When we came together with clear evidence of his message, and we have that in front of him, they say this is just a magic. Then let us look at the statement of Jesus in the book of John, chapter 16, verses 12 to 14. The book of John, chapter 16, verses 12 to 14. It is compulsory for any Muslim that is interested in propagating the message of Islam to be able to memorize the book of John chapter 16 verses 12 to 14, to compartmentalize it and commit it out to the church and explain it to them. John chapter 16 verses 12 to 14, this is what Jesus told the people. I have yet many things to say unto you, but you cannot bear them now. You cannot understand them. They are too heavy for you in your brain. You cannot bear them. However, when he, the Spirit of Truth, comes, he will guide you into all the truth. For he will not speak on his own authority, but whatsoever he shall hear, that is what he will say. For he shall receive some information about me, and he will pass this information to you, and he will make me to be honored, and he will show you the judgment to come. How many? Eight of the genders. I have yet many things to say unto you, and you cannot bear them now. However, when he, the Spirit of Truth, your family, and then we'll show you the judgment of God. We have, who was this?
The helper or the counselor, they translated the original
and he shall send unto you another comforter that will abide with you forever and ever. Another comforter. Does another comforter mean another Holy Spirit? No. Because we have only one Holy Spirit. Another comforter means another prophet. A prophet, because Jesus is a prophet. The Bible addressed him as a prophet of God. In Luke chapter 24, verse 19, Jesus is called a prophet of God. In Mark chapter 3, verse 4, Jesus is called a prophet of God. In Luke chapter 19, verse 33, Jesus is called a prophet of God. In John chapter 3, verse 14, Jesus is called a prophet of God. In Luke chapter 3, verse 16, Jesus is called a prophet of God. In Matthew chapter 21, verse 17, Jesus is called a prophet of God. And in Matthew chapter 21, verse 46, Jesus is called a prophet of God. So Jesus was a prophet. The Last Testament. You know we have the Old Testament. We have the New Testament. And we also have the Last Testament. The Bible addressed the Quran as what? The Last Testament. In 1 Corinthians chapter 13, verses 9 to 10. 1 Corinthians chapter 13, verses 9 to 10. The Bible says, for we know in part, and we prophesy in part. But when that which is complete form, when that which is perfect form, the incomplete one will be kept aside. What is that perfect revelation? That is the glorious Quran. Because the Bible is not the perfect revelation. If you want the Bible to be perfect revelation, you will be able to find it. Are you talking of the King James Version, the Revised Standard Version, the Catholic Bible, the Living Bible, the International Bible, the New English Bible, the last book of the Bible and the Holy Book of Annals, the New World Translation of the Scriptures given by the Holy Prophet, the New American Version of the Bible, the Gospel of Barnabas, the Book of Mormon, the Corporation Bible? Which Bible are you talking about? Even the Christians themselves have confirmed, you know, the proliferation of errors, contradictions, discrepancies, you know, blasphemies, inconsistencies, historical anachronism and grammatical errors in the Bible. This is mentioned in the preface of the Revised Version by the particular scholars of the highest eminence, backed up by 15 different cooperating denominations. They said that the Christian version of the New Testament was based upon a Greek text that was married by mistake, containing the accumulated errors of 14 centuries of manuscript copying. This is written in the preface of the Revised Version of 1952 and the preface of the Revised Version of 1971. The further says in the book of in the same preface that yet the Christian version of the New Testament was based upon a Greek text. The Christian version of the New Testament has great defects. The development of the biblical study and the discovery of many manuscripts more ancient than those upon which the Christian version was based make it manifest that these defects are so many and so serious as to call for the revision of the English translation. And that is why you see us with different versions of the Bible today. If you present a Bible to a Christian, he will say that which Bible it is. This one will be our church Bible too. That the Catholic Bible. No, this one Jehovah's Witness Bible will not believe in this. And that is the reason why one of the Western imperialists, one of the Western orientalists, in the person of Dr. Maurice Duplessis, in the book entitled The Bible, the Quran, and Modern Science. This man was a French from a Catholic scientist. He mentioned in page 120 of his book that while monumental errors are to be found in the Bible, I cannot find a single error in the Quran. And he finally accepted the religion of Islam. The same thing with Professor Ken Enmo, professor of embryology. You know, he discovered some biological and scientific errors in the Bible. You know, and he also wrote a book on embryology, and he discovered some errors in his book, which he corrected. You go to chapter 19 of the Quran, you read how Jesus was born. And alhamdulillah, the reciter of the Quran just opens that chapter and you read it. How Jesus Christ was born. We have a surah in the Quran, chapter 19, which is called Surah Al-Maryam. As the Christian, Surah Al-Maryam means chapter named, a chapter that is named after the mother of Jesus, chapter named. As the Christian, do you have Surah Al-Maryam chapter Mary in the Bible?
No.
Even the first miracle that Jesus did on earth, which cannot be found in the Bible, is mentioned here. According to the Quran, the first miracle that Jesus did on earth, he spoke to the people the very day he was born. The day that Jesus Christ was born,
he started
change was that he changed what happened. How old A Christian should be sent to show to me that he cannot remember in what the Quran says that Jesus spoke the day he was born, simply because this miracle is not mentioned in his Bible. Then I refer him to the book of John chapter 20, verse 30, where the Bible says, Jesus did many other miracles, signs and wonders in the presence of his disciples, which are not recorded in this book. In the presence of his disciples, which are not recorded in this book, I ask which book? He said this book. I say which book? He said Bible. He said of God our life.
He created a man
from a
woman
without a son, a whole son man. Jesus was created from Mary without a father. Eve was created from a man, Adam, without a mother. So if you call Jesus the son of God because he has no father, do you call him the daughter of God? Do you call Adam the son of God? Adam that has no father and no mother? What about the angels? The angels are neither male nor female. And God Almighty created them from what? From life. They are parents. Therefore, Jesus said, he will tell you many things about me, and he will show you the judgment to come. Look, if the Christian want to know Jesus, let them come to the mountain. Jesus belongs to us. Jesus is our hope. Let me know our hope. I am telling you, if you want to know Jesus, come to the mountain. We tell you the account of Jesus. We tell you the story of Jesus. You know? Finally, John, chapter 14, verse 30 of the Revised Version of the Bible. Jesus said, I will no longer talk much with you because the ruler of this world is coming. I will no longer talk much with you because the ruler of this world is coming. I was preaching at Agege. One Christian asked me. He said, you want to know? Who was the ruler of this world that was to come after Jesus Christ? I said, you, who do you think he was? Then we started thinking and contemplating. He did not know what to say. Later he said, Satan. Satan. I said, was Satan not in the world when Jesus was in the world? Does your Bible not say that Jesus was tempted by Satan for 40 days in the book of Luke chapter 4 was about to do and Matthew chapter 4 was about to do? He said, of course, he said, okay, now who be on now? Now who be that ruler? The ruler of the world that was to come after Jesus. I said, he is none other than the universal prophet that will tell the world into all the truth in the person of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. It was the same person that was telling me at Agege that he saw Jesus Christ in the cloud. I said, you saw Jesus in the cloud, he said, yes. And we are here at Oshun. I said, you say, for me, how are you sure that it was Jesus? He said, I know it not because I have his picture. I have his picture with me. I told Jesus. Then I said, please, can you help me to read the book of Matthew chapter 24, verse 23? In your Bible? He opened the Bible and he started reading. Where Jesus said, if anyone say unto you, here is the Christ, or here he is, or I have seen him in your corner, don't believe him. He said, oh God, I don't confuse you. Now who I see in the cloud, I think that Satan. And people started laughing. He was confounded. My testimony was his name. You know, so therefore, the Christians are confused. It happened in the Jerusalem garden. And here, Ivan, at that time I was in Sudan when this incident happened. And I came and made my own proper investigation with full analysis. Look, this issue of miracle that the Christians are saying that they are performing, it is not a miracle party, but it is magic, magic in disguise. And you understand? You know, it is a sheep, you know, in the wolf clothing. You know, what are they doing? Miracle? If any Christian wants to perform miracle, let him come to the Muslims. We will give you the test. We will give you the test if you can perform it. Look, Bishop Abodurin of Ibadan, the Apostolic Church of Ibadan, one of the Pentecostal churches. A particular Sunday, and he said that I am going to show you that Jesus is alive. I am going to show you that Jesus is God. I am going to show you that Jesus is the Son of God. I am going to inside the various verses that we have read chronologically, and he did a mighty move and a copy of the Bible. And he dropped to the University of Ibadan, the Rutherford Garden. The Matthew of Ibadan, the Rutherford Garden. You know? And he made the whole congregation of the Christians to surround that the Rutherford Garden of the Matthew of Ibadan. And he surrounded it. There we are clapping. Jesus power, Jesus power, Jesus power, Jesus power.
Yeah. to enlighten more, to give us more enlightenment, so that we understand what we are doing in life and the good steps that we are. So another surprise of this is that I can say that I got the result of yesterday, I will give it to the man. Because I was totally convinced. So that is why I first myself appreciate the man, because he gave us reason beyond reasonable doubt for we to know that what we stand is the truth. But I'm a struggle Christian too, because I have been blessed in Christ too. But
Jesus, that is his salah. The claim that he was born.
when he said, Wassalamu alayya, the peace of Allah is on me. Yawm ulidtu, the very day I was born, wa yawm amutu, and on the day that I shall die, wa yawm ub'athu hayya, and on the day, the final day of judgment, ub'athu hayya, when Allah will bring me back to life. This verse is not talking about the death and resurrection of Jesus in the Christian church. I don't understand. Because the Christians are saying that Jesus died for 3 days and he was buried and he resurrected. Yesterday, we deny that statement with the statement of the Bible in Matthew chapter 4, verse 38 rules, which I will quote later. I don't understand. This same statement uttered by Jesus, you know, has been said on John the Baptist even before Jesus in the same Quran. I don't understand. Quran chapter 19, verse 15 to 16, about John the Baptist. Anna says to John the Baptist, Wassalamu alayhi, yawm ulida, wa yawm yamutu, wa yawm yub'athu hayya. The peace of Anna will be on John the Baptist. The day he was born, the day that he shall die, and the day that he shall be raised up alive. Then the John the Baptist also died and was buried. So it's talking about what? On the day of judgment, all the prophets of God will be in peace with God on the day of judgment. It's not talking about the death and resurrection of Jesus, because basically, Jesus did not die for 3 days. And he did not return, according to Matthew chapter 12, verses 38 to 40. One of the, you know, Jewish people asked Jesus, Master, we need a sign from you. Jesus said, I will not show you any other miracle. I will not show you any other sign except the miracle of John.
So I was teaching a school telling Allah said the people of God were mad. I was translating them for the students. My principal said that Abijah, don't be deceived by my children, that the Lord said in the Bible that let's create man as in our own image. I asked him that when the Lord was found saying, who was he talking to? Who was he referring to? He said that the Holy Spirit was there, the Jesus Christ and the Lord was there, that these three people made people on board, that they now create the man as in our own image.
Your question now?
Now, the question I want to ask that, I don't know the meaning of that thing. I want the lecturer to enlighten on
us. In our own image, according to our own likeness, is mentioned in the book of Genesis chapter 1 verse 26 in the Bible. Genesis chapter 1 verse 26. What is the meaning of this statement? Let us create man in our own image, according to our own likeness, as mentioned in the book of Genesis chapter 1 verse 26. Then if you go to verse 27, from verse 26, and it's specific. And God created man in his own image. He said, let us create man in our own image. Then the Christians, meaning believers in the dogma of Trinity, they decided to explain or, you know, translate or elaborate on that pronoun of as God, the presence of the Holy Spirit and Jesus. Ask them to open that portion of the Bible in the book of Genesis chapter 1 verse 26. Let them show you where the name of Jesus is mentioned. Let them show you where the name of the Holy Spirit is mentioned. Look, in the Semitic language, when I say in Semitic language, in Eastern language, when I say in Eastern language, I mean the language of the Jews and the Arabs. We have two kinds of plurals. P-N-U-R-A-L-S. We have two types of plurals. First, we have plural of respect, which is called plural of power, which is called plural of majesty, which is called plural of honor, you know, which is called plural of supremacy used by the Almighty God. Even in the Quran we have it. We. When the word we, when Allah used the word we, what does Allah mean by that we? what does Allah mean by that Allah? Does that mean that Allah is more than one? No.
That is
plural of power. What is the president of Nigeria? The president and the governor in chief in Nigeria, can you use it in his capacity as the president? He has his own minister working under him. He has his own armed forces working under him. He has his own security organization and other political office holders working under him, like the governor of this state. You know, in his capacity as the governor of this state, whenever he is talking, he will say, we. Does that mean that Edo State has more than one government? What is that we used for? It is a plural of power used by him. You know, because he gives an order. So the Almighty God has his angels working on that. The angels of God. And then the minister of God. I said the angels of God. And then the minister of God. They are the minister of God. They are the angels of God. God can send his angels to go and destroy. You know, we have the angel of death. We have the angels, different kind of angels. Working on that one. The fire is a soldier of God, because God can send the fire to go and destroy. The sea, meaning the ocean, is a soldier of God, because God Almighty can send the ocean to go and consume people.
صدق الله العظيم المتوحد في الجلال بكمال الجمال تعظيما وتكبيرا الذي نزل
من between the religion of Christianity and that of Islam. Christianity as a religion, though some of the Christians, especially our pastor of yesterday, says Christianity is not a religion but rather it is a way of life.
فرقان على عبده ليكون للعالمين نذيرا وبلغ رسوله الكريم الذي أرسل
وعلى آله وصحبه ومن والاه وما توفيق إلا لله عليه توكلت وإليه أنيب. The last of the spiritual messengers and teachers from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, as emphasized by various prophets of God in the Bible, like in the book of Genesis, in chapter 49, verse 1. In the book of Genesis, in chapter 49, verse 10. In the book of Deuteronomy, in chapter 33, verse 1 to 3. In the book of Deuteronomy, in chapter 18, verse 15. In Deuteronomy, in chapter 18, verses 18 to 21. In the book of Isaiah, in chapter 13, verse 17. In the book of Isaiah, in chapter 21, verse 7. In the book of Isaiah, in chapter 42, verses 1 to 12. In the book of Isaiah, in chapter 60, verses 1 to 7. In the book of Jeremiah, in chapter 8, verse 29. In the book of Habakkuk, in chapter 3, verse 3. In the book of John, in chapter 16, verse 14. In the book of John, in chapter 16, verse 30. In the book of John, in chapter 16, verses 7 to 9. The book of John, chapter 16, verses 12 to 14, the book of Matthew, chapter 11, verse 11, in the person of Muhammad, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, his household, his companions, and all those that have accepted the guidance until the day of mutual illusion and dissolution. I greet you all with the divine Islamic formula of greetings, as enshrined and stipulated in the Bible also, like in the book of Genesis, in chapter 43, verse 23, in the book of Numbers in chapter 6 verse 26, in the book of Judges in chapter 6 verse 23, in the book of 1 Samuel in chapter 1 verse 17, in the book of 1 Samuel in chapter 25 verse 6, in the book of Luke in chapter 10 verse 5, in the book of Luke in chapter 24 verse 36, in the book of John in chapter 20 verse 19, in the book of John in chapter 20 verse 21, and the book of John in chapter 20 verse 26, and confirming the glorious to us in chapter 6 verse 54, as well as in chapter 24 verse 27, which is Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. May the peace and blessings of Almighty God be upon all of you. We give thanks to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for giving us this opportunity to stand before this important congregation and deliver a speech or a talk on a topic which is the religion of all nations. It is a fact beyond denial that in the world there are many religions in the world in circulation, and every religion claims divinity. All religions claim divinity, and they claim their religion is for all nations. In existence, we have religions like Buddhism. Buddhism is a religion that derives its origin from Buddha, and this religion is concentrated mainly in India, in Nepal, and in Vietnam. These are the only countries where you find Buddhism. So Buddhism, having no any divine revelation, having no any messenger sent from God the Almighty, is only confined to those people in those areas, so it cannot be considered as a religion of all nations. We have other religions like Christianity that is found mainly in Japan, in China, in Korea. Confucianism is a religion that derives its origin from a man called Confucius, and such a man is not a messenger of God. There is no any revelation that comes from God Almighty, and it is only confined to those areas I mentioned, therefore it can claim universality. Now the point of discussion here remains between the religion of Christianity and that of Islam. Christianity as a religion, though some of the Christians, especially our pastor of yesterday, says Christianity is not a religion, but rather it is a way of life. Consider it as a religion or a way of life. Now, do we consider the religion of Christianity as a universal religion? And then we come back to Islam. Where does Christianity derive its origin? According to the Christian, the Christianity derives its origin from the man Christ. Even though facts, investigations and findings have beyond reasonable doubt confirmed that Jesus was not the founder of Christianity. Christianity came after Jesus had already left. So the question that remains before the Christian to answer is, which was the religion of Jesus Christ? What was his own religion? Because Christianity came after he had already left. But all facts has been established that Paul is the founder of the religion of Christianity. Now, let's assume for the sake of discussion that Jesus Christ is the founder of the religion of Christianity. Then, does that mean that Christianity is a universal religion? Was Jesus sent to the whole universe? Was he a universal prophet? Was the revelation that was given to him revealed to universality or to a particular portion of people of earth? That is what also we are going to look at in order to judge whether Christianity is a religion for all nations, in which the Hausas, the Igbos, the Yorubas, and all other tribes we have here, the Nigerians, the Koreans, the South, all are supposed to embrace. Now, the religion of Islam. The religion of Islam, you know, is a different religion when compared to all the other religions I have cited. All other religions I have cited, they derive their origin either from a man, from a tribe, from a geographical location, but Islam derives its origin directly from God the Almighty. And this is the only religion that has its origin traced to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone. Allah has clearly mentioned in the glorious Quran In chapter 3, verse 19, Allah says, in Medina, in the law, Al-Islam, the only true and accepted religion in the sight of Allah is Islam. That is why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in glorious Quran, he explained in details about the religion of Islam. The word Islam appeared in the Quran in not less than six times. Allah mentioned in chapter 3 verse 19 that inna dina indallah ala Islam, the only religion in the sight of Allah is Islam. Allah mentioned in chapter 3 verse 85, he said, وَمَنْ يَبْتَغِ غَيْرَ الْإِسْلَامِ دِينًا فَلَنْ يُقْبَلَ مِنْهُ وَهُوَ فِي الْآخِرَةِ مِنَ الْخَاسِرِينَ. Any person that seeks any other religion beside Islam, Allah is not going to accept such a religion from him, and in the hereafter he's going to be among the losers. So Allah mentioned Islam here. In chapter 5, verse 3, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Al-Yawma akmaltu lakum dinakum wa atmamtu alaykum ni'mati wa raditu lakum Islam adina, that today I have completed your religion unto you, and I have perfected my favor upon you, and I have chosen for you Islam as a way of life and religion. In chapter 6, verse 14, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, فَمَنْ يُرِدُ اللَّهَ أَنْ يَهْدِيَهُ يَشْرَحَ صَدْرَهُ لِلْإِسْلَامِ. Whosoever Allah wants to guide, he opens his chest, his breast, to understand of Islam. Again, in chapter 6, verse 125, Allah mentioned about Islam. Again, in chapter 31, verse 22, Allah mentioned about Islam. Again, in chapter 49, verse 17, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned. In fact, Allah mentioned the religion of Islam in not less than 20 different places in the glorious Quran. In chapter 2, verse 112, in chapter 2, verse 131, in chapter 2, verse 208, in chapter 3, verse 19, in chapter 3, verse 20, in chapter 3, verse 83, in chapter 3, verse 85, in chapter 4, verse 125, in chapter 5, verse 3, in chapter 6, verse 14, in chapter 6, verse 125, Allah mentioned about the religion of Islam. In chapter 1, chapter 31, verse 22, in chapter 39, verse 22, in chapter 39, verse 54, in chapter 49, verse 17, and as well as in chapter 74, verse 12, Allah mentioned Islam as a religion that he has chosen for the inhabitants of this world. So the religion of Islam derived its origin directly from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, which no any other religion on earth derived its origin from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala except Islam. Now since we heard that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the originator, the founder of the religion of Islam, and no any other human being, not Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and now the comparison is this religion of Islam a universal religion or not? As I stand before you, quoting several verses in the Quran where Islam is mentioned, there is not a single mention of Christianity in the whole Bible. That means from Genesis to Revelation, the word Christianity cannot be traced anywhere in the Bible. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala called Muslims, those that embrace the religion of Islam, as Muslims. Allah called them and identified their name as Muslims in the glorious Quran in about 25 different places. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala identified the name of those that accept Islam as Muslims in the Quran in not less than 25 different places in the glorious Quran. I don't have to call it, but they are there. We can give you references to go and check in the glorious Quran that about 25 times Allah has mentioned the religion of Islam there. I mean the Muslims there. Where in the whole Bible, Christians are mentioned in only three places. One in the book of Acts in chapter 11 verse 26, two in the book of Acts of Apostles in chapter 26 verse 8, and three in the book of 1 Peter in chapter 4 verse 16. These are the only three places where the name Christian is mentioned in the Bible. One, it was after Christians, when the disciples were 11 in Antioch as Christians. Second, it was a quarrel between Paul and one of the disciples, which he wanted King Agrippa to intervene. And King Agrippa confessed and he said that you almost
first, first need to be a Christian. That's where it is mentioned. That is in the book of Acts in chapter 26, verse 28. And finally, Paul mentioned in 1 Peter in chapter 4, verse 16, that anyone that suffered as a Christian, not let him not be ashamed. These are the only three places where the name Christian is mentioned in the Bible. Besides, there's nowhere.
This is there in the book of Matthew, in chapter 2, verse 3, as well as in chapter 2, verse 6. That when Jesus was born, King Herod became afraid because he knew it is written in the scripture that somebody is going to be born in his land that is going to rule his own people. And that was Jesus Christ from the Virgin Mary. Now, when Jesus was facing his own trial on the cross, when he was taken before the court of the Pontius Pilate, part of the allegation they raised against him was that, "Are you the king of the Jew?" They asked him question in the book of Matthew, in chapter 2, verse 2. They asked him this question in the book of Mark, in chapter 15, verse 2. They asked him this question in the book of Luke, in chapter 23, verse 3. And in chapter 23, verse 33, they asked him this particular question. In the book of John, in chapter 18, verse 33, similar question was asked by this Pontius Pilate, that, "Are you the king of the Jew?" The Bible told us that when he was facing trial, there was a superscription put it on his head that this is Jesus Christ, the king of the Jew. So how can the king of the Jew be a universal prophet? A woman of Samaria came. She brought her daughter that was possessed. She wanted Jesus Christ to assist her. She said, "Pastor, help me." Her daughter was possessed and she was shouting. Jesus Christ ignored her. The disciples were complaining. They were thinking to their master, "Why don't you assist this woman so that she will leave us here?" He said, "Is it possible to take the bread that belongs and give it to dogs?" Jesus says the Gentiles are dogs. He addressed them as dogs, even in the book of Matthew, in chapter 7, verse 6. He said that thou wilt take that which is holy and offer it to dogs, nor shall you give it to swine. He addressed the Jew as swine, as pork, and as dogs. The woman insisted. Disciples were complaining. Jesus Christ said, "Look, I am not sent but only to the lordship of the house of Israel. So therefore, my territory is only within the Israelite. I cannot extend my help to a woman that belongs to Gentiles. She is not among the Jew. I cannot assist her." So that shows the limitation of the message of Jesus Christ. He was only sent to the Jew. When Jesus Christ was sending disciples to go and preach the gospel to the whole world, according to the book of Matthew, in chapter 10, verse 36, Jesus says, "Go ye into the world and preach the gospel." This is what most of the Christians call. They will cut verse 5 and stop there. Jesus says, "Go ye into the world and preach the gospel." As such, he was a universal prophet. Then in verse 6, he said, "But thou shalt not go to the way of the Gentiles, nor the house of the Samaritans, but go ye only to the lordship of the house of Israel." Of course, he told them that they should go to the whole world. But if you go to the whole world, you should restrict your teachings only to the Jew. You should not go to the way of the Gentiles, nor the house of the Samaritans, but go ye only to the lordship of the house of Israel. And the Bible confirmed that when the disciples went out, when they went out to preach the gospel, they limited their teachings only to the Jew. Is there in the book of Acts, in chapter 11, verse 26 of the Bible, when they went out, they only preached among the Jews only. They did not go beyond that. But Islam, as a religion of all nations, Islam believed in all the prophets and messengers of God. All prophets of God that came from God Almighty, from Adam down to Jesus, they were all Muslims and they practiced Islam. Right from Adam to Enoch to Noah to Abraham to Ishmael to Isaac, Jacob to God, to John to Jonah to Joshua to Joshua to Jeremiah to David to Solomon to Moses to Aaron. Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that we are all Muslims and they all practice Islam. That is why Islam encouraged, Allah mentioned in the glorious Quran, that we have to believe in all the messengers. If you disbelieve in any one of them, you are no longer a Muslim. That's why in chapter 2 verse 136, as well as in chapter 3 verse 84, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, قُلُوا آمَنَّا بِاللَّهِ وَمَا أُنزِلَ إِلَيْنَا وَمَا أُنزِلَ إِلَىٰ إِبْرَاهِيمَ وَإِسْمَاعِيلَ وَإِسْحَاقَ وَيَعْقُوبَ وَالْأَسْبَاطِ وَمَا أُوتِيَ مُوسَى وَعِيسَى وَمَا أُوتِيَ النَّبِيُّونَ مِن رَّبِّهِمْ لَا نُفَرِّقُ بَيْنَ أَحَدٍ مِّنْهُمْ وَنَحْنُ لَهُ مُسْلِمُونَ. قُلُوا آمَنَّا بِاللَّهِ, so we believe in Allah, وَمَا أُنزِلَ إِلَيْنَا, and what was revealed unto us, وَمَا أُوتِيَ إِلَىٰ إِبْرَاهِيمَ وَإِسْمَاعِيلَ وَإِسْحَاقَ وَيَعْقُوبَ وَالْأَسْبَاطِ, and what was revealed to Abraham, to Ishmael, to Isaac, and to the children of Israel, وَمَا أُوتِيَ مُوسَى وَعِيسَى, and what was revealed to Moses and Jesus, لَا نُفَرِّقُ بَيْنَ أَحَدٍ مِّنْهُمْ. We don't segregate, we don't a dichotomy, we don't differentiate among any one of them. وَنَحْنُ لَهُ مُسْلِمُونَ, and we to them we have submitted ourselves as Muslims. Technical says Islam means total, complete, absolute, and unconditional submission to the will of God Almighty. So if you submit yourself unconditionally to God Almighty, you are a Muslim. By the time you submit yourself, when Allah says to Abraham, when Allah said to Abraham, submit yourself, become a Muslim, Allah said, as long to the Rabbil Alameen, I have submitted myself to the Lord of the world. That means he has become a Muslim. So technically, Islam means total submission to the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And all the messengers of God, like from Adam to Jesus, they all submitted themselves to the will of Allah, and such they were all Muslims. Therefore, Islam is the religion of all nations. That is why when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is given the ta'arif of Jesus in the glorious Quran, you understand, in chapter 5 verse 75, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, مَا الْمَسِيْهُ مَنْيَمَ إِلَّا رَسُولًا كَدَا تَلَكُ مِنْ قَبْلِهِ الرُّسُولِ وَأُمُهُ سِدِّيقًا. That Jesus, the son of Mary, is not more than a messenger of God, and many were messengers like him that came and passed away. Many were messengers like him that were devoted to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that submitted themselves to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and they came and passed away. So he wasn't a different person from other messengers that came before him. So therefore, when you look at the Bible, you see that Abraham, the father of all nations, you understand? Abraham worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the way and manner the Muslims are worshiping Allah today. He fell down with his face to the ground and worship Allah in the book of Genesis in chapter 17 verse 3. After Abraham, Moses and Aaron used to come to the temple. They would perform ablution as God has instructed Moses. After performing ablution, they enter the temple and the both of them would fall down together. Is there in the book of Numbers, in chapter 20 verse 6, they fell down with their faces just as Moses had been, and they worshiped God. Daniel did the same thing. In the book of Daniel, in chapter 6 verse 10, 10 times daily, he will go down and fall down with the sword of the ground and worship God Almighty, the way Muslims are doing. You know? And then Joshua, in the book of Joshua, in chapter 5 verse 14, he did the similar thing, the way Muslims are doing. That is how Daniel will fall down with the sword of the ground and worship God Almighty. After Daniel has done that, you see the angels are also falling down with their faces to the ground and worship God Almighty. Look at the book of Revelation in chapter 9, verse 11. You see, in chapter 7, verse 11, you see the way angels are falling down with their faces to the ground and worship God. That was the practice of Jesus himself, the son of the Virgin Mary. Jesus fell down and stepped to the ground to worship God. In the book of Matthew, in chapter 26, verse 39, in the book of Luke, in chapter 22, verse 41 to 43, in the book of Mark, in chapter 1, verse 35,
When he realized that he was in a great tribulation, he carried defense, you know, he made an army strategy, took 11 disciples, and then he went to Gethsemane, you know, where is a secure place over the night he traveled out. He placed 8 of the soldiers, his disciples, at the gate, went out, and he entered inside with 3 of them, and he said, "Tarry here and watch over with me, for I will go and pray yonder." When he entered the garden, the room, he fell down with himself to the ground and worshiped God, and prayed to God, "If it is possible, take away this cup of death from me, but nevertheless, not my own will, but your own will shall be done." He completely submitted his will to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and that is what characterizes a true Muslim. So therefore, Jesus Christ was a Muslim in the sense that he also submitted himself so totally to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now, what is the yardstick? What yardstick should we use to judge as which of the religions is a universal religion of God the Almighty? I saw an angel flying in the midst of the sky, carrying an everlasting gospel to preach to all nations. That means the gospel belongs to the religion of all nations, because the gospel is to be preached to all nations. Now the question is, which gospel is that? Is it the Bible? A very good Christian will answer you, yes, that means it's the Bible, because John the historian is mentioned in the Bible, and the Bible says he saw an angel flying in the midst of the sky carrying an everlasting gospel. Now, analyze the statement. The angel was carrying an everlasting gospel. Everlasting gospel means a gospel that cannot be amended, a gospel that cannot be revised, a gospel that cannot be edited, a gospel that cannot be tempered, a gospel that cannot be changed. You know, you cannot change it. It remains as it is. So when you say it's the Bible, we ask you a question. Which of the Bibles? Is it the New English Bible? Or the New International Version of the Bible? Is it the New American Standard Bible? Is it the New American Translation of the Holy Bible? Is it the Living Bible? The Amplified Bible? The Good News Bible? The King James Version? The Revised Standard Version of 1952? Or the Revised Standard Version of 1971? Or the Lost Book of the Bible and Forgotten Book of Eden? Or the Everyday Bible? No? Which of the versions of the Bible, in the New Jerusalem Bible, the Little Catholic Game version of the Bible, which version of the Bible is such an everlasting gospel? Now, if you say an everlasting gospel means a gospel that cannot be revised or edited or changed, then Bible is not qualified to be the everlasting gospel. In chapter 4, verse 82, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, "Afala yatadabbarun al-Qur'an walau kana min 'indi ghayri Allah lawajadu fihi ikhtilafan katira." Will you not ponder on the glorious Quran? Had this Quran is from anyone other than Allah, then there would have been a lot of discrepancies there. There would have been a lot of historical fallacy. There would have been a lot of contradiction. There would have been a lot of, you know, interpolations, plagiarism, you know, anachronism, all sorts of additions and fusions would have been in the glorious Quran. So therefore, any scripture that claims divinity, we now subject the scripture on this Islamic Quranic parameter. So if Bible is devoid of contradictions, it is devoid of interpolations, then we say the Bible is the everlasting gospel and is a revelation from God the Almighty. Now, analyzing this particular verse of Revelation 46, with a verse in the glorious Quran, or some verses in the glorious Quran, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala defines Quran, in chapter 26, verse 190 to 196, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala defines Quran. Allah says, "Innahu latanzilu rabbil alameen, nazala bihi ruhul amin. Allah يجب أن تكون من المنذرين بلسان عربي مبين." وإنه لتزول الأولين. Allah defined Quran in these two verses of the glorious Quran. إنه لتزول رب العالمين. Indeed, Quran is a revelation from the Lord of the worlds. نزل به نور الأمين. It was descended by the Spirit of Truth. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Allah can be put onto your heart, O Muhammad, لتكون من المنذرين so that you be among the wonders, بلسان عربي مبين in a clear Arabic language. وَإِنَّهُ لَتُزُّكُ الْأَوَّلَيْنِ And this Quran can be authenticated from the previous scriptures. Now, the Bible confirms that this everlasting gospel that the angel was carrying, it was revealed out onto the heart of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam for the guidance of mankind. In the book of Isaiah, in chapter 29, verse 12, the Bible says, And a book was revealed unto him, who is not learned, saying, Read. He said, I am not learned. Read, I pray thee. He said, I am not learned. Who is that person? If you could remember, when the first revelation came to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in the cave of Hira, the angel told him, Iqra, read. He said, Ma alaykum, I don't know how to read. This is exactly what the Bible is now narrating to us. And a book was revealed unto him, who is not learned, saying, Read. He said, I am not learned. Read, I pray thee. He said, I am not learned. Who is this person? Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. If you like, you go back and check the Bible. Go and check the preface of the New English Bible. The translators wrote in the preface, they said, This book, though arriving late from the current translation scene, it has been underway for many years. It has undergone several major manuscript revisions. It has been under a careful scrutiny of a team of Greek and Hebrew experts to check English content and critics for style. Though there are many suggestions has been largely followed, none of those that have been consulted are entirely satisfied with the current result. Therefore, this is called a tentative edition. Therefore, many suggestions are welcome for the future printing. Many suggestions are welcome. The writers are telling you that even though they made consultations, the result they have reached is a tentative result. Therefore, if you have suggestions, you can give them. This is in the preface of the New English Bible. Look at the preface of the Living Bible. Also, they condemn the authenticity of what they wrote. Look at the preface of the Revised Standard Version of 1952. They condemn the authenticity of the King James Version. They say the King James Version of 1611 is marked by mistake, containing accumulated errors from the 14th century. So they condemn it. Now, that is what has to do with the writers or translators of the Bible. Now, come back to check the content of the Bible. Are there contradictions or not? Let's look at some examples and put for that. Now, in the Bible, when you look at the book of Genesis, in chapter 6, verse 3, the Bible says, A man shall not live for more than 120 years. A man shall not live for more than 120 years. But at the same time, in the same Bible, in the book of Genesis, in chapter 9, verse 29, Noah lived for how many years? 950 years. The Bible says a man will not live for more than 120 years, and Noah lived for 950 years. Look at the Bible again. In the book of John, in chapter 1, verse 18, the book of 1 John, in chapter 4, verse 12, the Bible says no man has ever seen God. No eye has ever seen God. In the book of Exodus, in chapter 24, verses 9 to 10, the Bible says 74 people saw God. Moses, Aaron, Nadab, and Abihu, and 17 other elders of Israel, they saw God. In in the book of Galatians, in chapter 5, verse 23, that if you are circumcised, Christ would not profit you with anything. For Paul also mentioned in the book of 1 Corinthians, in chapter 7, verse 19, that circumcision is nothing. The Bible mentioned in the book of 1 John, in chapter 5, verse 1, that God Almighty is a light. He is a light, and there is no darkness with God. In the book of Psalm, in chapter 18, verse 11, the Bible says God is surrounded by darkness. Now, again, in the book of Matthew, in chapter 1, verse 16, we are told that the father of Joseph the carpenter, the bottle of Mary, his father's name is Jacob. But in the book of Luke, in chapter 3, verse 23, they say his father's name is Eli, not Jacob, it's Eli. Jesus mentioned in the book of John, in chapter 8, verse 14, that if I bear record of myself, my record is true. And he mentioned in the book of John, in chapter 5, verse 31, that if I bear record of myself, my record is not true. Jesus mentioned in the book of John, in chapter 10, verse 30, that I and the Father are one. He further mentioned in the book of John, in chapter 14, verse 28, that the Father is greater than I. I and the Father are one, and the Father is greater than I. The Bible mentioned in the book of Genesis, in chapter 5, verse 32, that when the flood of Noah happened on earth, Noah was 500 years old. The same Bible mentioned in the book of Genesis, in chapter 7, verse 6, that Noah was 600 years old when the flood of Noah happened. The story of the fishermen, according to the Bible, in the book of Luke, in chapter 5, verse 1, it happened before the beginning of Jesus' ministry. And the same Bible mentioned in the book of John, in chapter 13, verse 1, that the story of the fishermen happens after Jesus has resurrected. The Bible taught us that Israel is the first son of God in the book of Exodus, in chapter 4, verse 22, and in the book of Jeremiah, 31, verse 9, we are told that Ephraim is the first son of God. Who is the first son of God? In the book of John, in 3:16, Jesus is the only begotten son of God. In the book of Psalm, in 32, verse 7, David is under the begotten son of God. In the book of Matthew, in chapter 28, verse 1, when Jesus was in the tomb of Joseph of Arimathea, it was only Mary Magdalene that went on Sunday morning to anoint him. And when she went there, she met him as a bracket. But in the book of John, in chapter 20, verse 1, where I thought it was Mary Magdalene and Mary Magdalene, there are many countless number of contradictions regarding the Bible. Now, before the physical departure of Jesus Christ, Jesus Christ prophesies all the universality of the message, I mean of Islam, when he told them that I will no longer come with you, for the ruler of this world is coming. In the book of John, in chapter 14, verse 30, he said, I will no longer talk much with you, for the ruler of this world, ruler of this world is coming. Who is the ruler of this world? Meaning, he was not a universal messenger, then a universal messenger is coming after me, therefore I will no longer talk much with you, for that ruler is coming. You understand? Confessing that there is going to be a universal messenger that is coming after him. When he comes, he will rule all the world. So that shows the limitation of the message of Jesus Christ and the universality of the message of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. In the glorious Quran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned, وَمَا أَرْسَلْنَاكَ إِلَّا كَافَةً لِلنَّاسِ بَشِيرًا وَنَذِيرًا. In chapter 34, verse 28 of the glorious Quran, Allah said to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, وَمَا أَرْسَلْنَاكَ إِلَّا كَافَةً لِلنَّاسِ بَشِيرًا وَنَذِيرًا. We must send you except the whole mankind as a bringer of good, glad tidings and a warner. So Allah sent Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to the whole mankind. Allah, that is in the glorious Quran, chapter 34, verse 28. Again, in chapter 21, verse 107, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَمَا أَرْسَلْنَاكَ إِلَّا رَحْمَةً لِلْعَالَمِينَ. We must send you except as a mercy to the whole mankind. الله إليكم جميعا بالذي له ملك السماوات والأرض. قل say O Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم يا أيها الناس O you my guy إني رسول الله إليكم جميعا. I am indeed a messenger of Allah to all together. So the message of Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم about the Quran is in the constant message. When Allah gave me the Quran, He told me وكذلك أوحينا إليك قرآنا عربيا لتنذر أم القرى ومن حولها. That is how we reveal unto you Quran in a clear Arabic language so that you will warn the people of the mother town and those surrounding the mother town. So the message of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was a universal message as it is confirmed. Now, on the prophecy of John the historian, where he says that the angel that carried an everlasting gospel, such a gospel is to preach to all nations and to all people and to all kingdoms, and in comparison with the verse of the Quran I quoted, where Allah says it was sent to Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, لِتَكُونَ مِنَ الْمُنْذَرِينَ, so that you be among the waters, بِلِسَانٍ عَرَبِيٍّ مُبِينٍ, in a clear Arabic language. There was a time I came across a reverend father who wanted to know Islam. After explaining Islam for him within the context of the Bible, I reached this particular verse where Allah says Quran is revealed in a clear Arabic language. He now asked me, young man, do you mean you want to show me Arabic in the Bible? I said, yes, there is Arabic in the Bible. In the book of Zephaniah, in chapter 3, verse 9, God Almighty says, and in the last generation, I will change to people a pure language, so that they may all call upon the name of their Lord with that language, and serve him shoulder to shoulder, or serve him with one accord, or with one consent. In the last generation, I will change to people a pure language, so that they may all call upon the name of their Lord with that language. I am sure some of you must have gone to Yoruba land or Igbo land. Is there anyone of you here that has ever gone to Igbo land and heard the calling prayer, Chine Gaduba? Or maybe the Yoruba's Duba prayer, O Lord Akbar. Or the Esau will say, O Gaina Akbar. So that they will all call upon the name of their Lord with that language and serve their Lord shoulder to shoulder. Who are those that are serving Allah shoulder to shoulder? Sometimes a Christian came out to ask me a question. That look, my father is a Muslim, my mother is a Christian. I go to mosque and I go to church, so I have no problem. I said, you have the greatest of problems. Now, I ask you a question. When you go to church, what will you do? He kept quiet. I said, you dance? He said, yes. You sing? He said, yes. You clap? I said, yes. I said, I see the Bible. Can you show me the song that was sung by Jesus in the Bible? They are wondering that, okay, can you ask and show me how Jesus danced in church? I said, okay, what about mosque? When you go to mosque, what do you do? He said, I pray. How do you pray? He demonstrated. I said, bring the Bible and see the way you pray. And that was how Jesus prayed in the Bible. For all the messengers that came from Allah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned in chapter 16, verse 36, when I read about Asna, he fully opened the Rasul and he equaled Allah, which tells you to ولقد بعثنا في كل أمة رسولا أن اعبدوا الله واجتنبوا الطاغوت in chapter 16 verse 36. Again, in chapter 13 verse 7, Allah says, ولكل قوم هاد. Allah says, وإن أمة إلا خلا فيها نذير. There is no any analysis in every community, in every nation of people have sent a messenger. And the fundamental teaching of that messenger, Allah says, is worship Allah alone and eschew away from the worship of other creatures beside Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. To every community, to every nation, we have sent a messenger. And the fundamental teaching of that messenger is worship Allah alone and eschew away from the worship of other creatures beside Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And that is Islam. All the messengers that came, that was their message to their people. Look at David. When David came, I want to book my first chronicle in chapter 6, verse 17, verse 23. David told people that there is no God but one. And none is like unto God, and nobody is compared unto God Almighty. When Solomon came, he passed the same message. When Jeremiah came, he passed the same message. When Moses came, he was asked a question. What is the first and the most important commandment? He said, the first and the most important commandment is, hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one. That was the message of Moses. 600 years after Moses had left, Jesus came, and the same question was also posed before Jesus Christ. And he gave a similar answer, word to word, the Lord our God, the Lord is one. When Jesus was asked by the disciples, Master, what can we do to have eternal life? The ultimate aim of everybody on earth is to attain the eternal life, to have what? Kingdom of God after your death. So they were asking him, how can we get to the kingdom of heaven after our life? Jesus Christ did not tell them that the kingdom of God depends on he who believes in my death and resurrection. It's not really about redemption. It's not really about love and all the claims that the Christians are claiming that Jesus Christ came to die for your sin. He said the only way you can get to the kingdom of God is by knowing God as the only true God and Jesus Christ whom God has sent. So if you want to go to the kingdom of God, you believe in La ilaha illallah, Isa Rasulullah, otherwise you are not going to the kingdom of God. This is reported in Quran, in chapter 3, verse 72. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, لَقَدَ كَفَرَ الَّذِينَ قَالُوا إِنَّ اللَّهَ هُوَ الْمَسِيحُ بْنُ مَرْيَمَ وَقَالَ الْمَسِيحُ يَا بَنِي إِسْرَائِيلَ اعْبُدُوا اللَّهَ رَبِّي وَرَبَّكُمْ إِنَّهُ مَن يُشْرِكْ بِاللَّهِ فَقَدْ حَرَّمَ اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ الْجَنَّةَ وَمَا وَعَاهُ النَّارُ وَمَا لِلظَّالِمِينَ مِنْ أَنصَارٍ. The Quran reported Jesus saying, Allah says, لَقَدْ كَفَرَ الَّذِينَ قَالُوا إِنَّ اللَّهَ هُوَ الْمَسِيحُ بْنُ مَرْيَمَ. Indeed, they are disbelievers. Those that said that Jesus, the Son of Mary, is God, they are disbelievers. Allah says, وَقَالَ الْمَسِيحُ. And Jesus now said, يَا بَنِي إِسْرَائِيلَ, all you children of Israel, اعْبُدُوا اللَّهَ, worship Allah, إِنَّ رَبِّي وَرَبُّكُمْ, my Lord and your Lord. إِنَّهُ مَن يُشْرِكْ بِاللَّهِ, that anyone that ascribes or allocates or associates partnership to Allah, فَقَدْ حَرَّمَ اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ الْجَنَّةَ, Allah will forbid Jannah on him, وَمَا أَوَاهُ النَّارُ, and his final destination or abode will be the hellfire, وَمَا لِلظَّالِمِينَ مِنْ أَنصَارٍ, and for evil doers on that day they will have no helper. So that has been the teachings of Jesus Christ. He was a Muslim, he was directing his people to the worship of Allah alone and not worship of he himself. When the devil took him to the wilderness and showed him all the duties of this world, he said, this is the key. I will give you the key to all these duties, you see, but the condition is you should bow down to me and worship me. He said, you get it, Shaitan, get away, devil. For it is written that thou shalt worship none but God alone, and only him you shall serve. In the book of Matthew, in chapter 4, verses 8 to 10. So if Jesus should instruct and command people to worship God alone, then that qualifies him to be a very good Muslim, and he was a Muslim. And this worship of God is the fundamental teaching of Islam, and that has been the teaching of all the messengers, right from Adam to Jesus, alayhi salatu wasalam, and that qualifies all of them to be Muslims. And if they are Muslims, that means Islam is the universal religion and is the religion of all nations. In the final notice, many are times we are being carried away by miracles. We are being carried away by miracles. Miracle you are seeing is just a deception. Don't allow somebody to just go to the marine side and get all his ojuju and come and do this. Now, let me tell you, if I should stand before you now and show you my palm like this, and from here you can see your house, you can see your wife, you can see your children. You believe this is your house, this is your wife, and these are your children that are playing in the house. And I say, are you sure it's your house, it's your family? You say, yes. Okay, I am God. Believe me, I am God. Believe me. I say, okay, believe me, I am God, because only God can do this. Will you believe me? The only thing you will tell me is no. You must have a way of doing it, but you are not God. You must have another way of doing it, but you are not God. So when you see people displaying miracles, Jesus Christ mentioned in Matthew chapter 7 verse 1-3, he said that on that day, meaning on Yawm al-Qiyamah, many will come to me. They will say, Lord, Lord, have we not prophesied in your name? Have we not cast out devils in your name? Have we not performed miracle signs and wonders in your name? He said, I will tell them that, depart away from me. I know you not, you people of lawlessness. I don't know you. So miracle is what anybody can look. Even the miracles that Jesus Christ performed in his lifetime, which are recorded in the Bible, and even those that are not recorded in the Bible, there were other messengers of God that did more miraculous things than him. And those people were never addressed as God by their people. See, the wise men, the crowd, when they saw what Jesus Christ did during his lifetime, in the book of Matthew, in chapter 9, verse 8, when the crowd saw what he did, they glorified God for giving man such a power. They knew that the miracle was done by God Almighty through this man. He is not the one that did it. So they glorified God. When Jesus Christ raised Lazarus, he stood before the corpse of Lazarus and he prayed to God, praying, groaning in his mind, crying in his mind, that, oh God, bring back the life of this man so that the people that are standing around me will believe that you really sent me. So he prayed to God, and God Almighty resurrected Lazarus. That was how Jesus resurrected a dead body, right? Now what happened to Elisha? Elijah in 2 Kings, in chapter 13, verse 21, Elijah died. After his death, his bones decayed. Somebody died in the community and he was revived, and they brought him mistakenly on the grave of who? Elijah. So on placing him inside, his dead body now touches the decayed form of Elijah and he resurrected. Elijah is dead. Years ago he died. His bones were decayed, but the decayed bone of Elijah was resurrected a body. Is that not more miraculous than Jesus? And nobody addressed him as God? Look at what happened to Ezekiel. Ezekiel 37 verse 1-14. Who resurrected thousands of people at a time, at a go? And nobody addressed Ezekiel as God. If you are thinking about ascension to heaven, end of ascension to heaven, he did not even just die, he did not die at all, he ascended to heaven. That does not qualify him to be God. Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam also ascended to heaven. That is not of John in chapter 8, verse 2, he said, seek ye the truth, and the truth shall set you free. Not that you should go and seek for miracles. Who is going to open your eyes because you are blind? Who is going to make you to be healed or make you to make and to have money in life to make your life, you know, beautiful? It's not the end of life. So if now somebody tell you, okay, he is performing miracles, where did you get your miracles? Are you an apostle of God? I mean, are you a prophet of God? Are you a messenger of God? And even the messengers and prophets of God that did their miracle, they did their miracle through prayers to God the Almighty, for not going to the Marian side to obtain a juju and come and perform miracles. Now, such people that are performing miracles, let me call them to the table. Let us discuss with them in the light of our scripture and see where lies the truth. So at the end, I want to conclude by saying that the universal religion of God, or the religion of all nations, is no other than the religion of Islam, because of the fact we have already cited here. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has made it clearly clear in the glorious Quran, in chapter 34, verse 28, in the glorious Quran, in chapter 21, verse 108, in the glorious Quran, in chapter 17, verse 107, Allah has made it clear for us that Islam is the religion for all nations, and He is not going to accept from anybody that seeks any other religion besides Islam. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَمَنْ يَتْرِ بَيْرُ الْإِسْلَامِ دِينًا فَلَنْ يُقْبَلَ مِنْهُ وَهُوَ فِي الْآخِرَةِ مِنَ الْخَاسِرِينَ. Anyone that seek any other religion besides Islam, Allah is not going to accept from him, and in the hereafter he is going to be among the losers. May Allah not let us be among the losers. May we die as Muslims in the dream of Islam. وَسَلَامُ عَلَيْكُمْ وَرَحْمَةُ اللَّهِ.
المتوحد في الجلال بكمال الجمال تعظيما وتكبيرا الذي نزل الفرقان على عبده ليكون للعالمين نذيرا.